Welcome to Lecture 2.3, Newton's Second Law of Motion. An alternate title for this lecture could have been Falling Objects with Air Resistance. Here is Newton's Second Law of Motion. You've probably seen it before in a former math or physics class. It's F equals ma, force is mass times acceleration. So we have a falling object. The first force that is going to act on it is gravity. So we have gravitational acceleration, which is going to be I'm going to write it as negative g, where g is 9.81 meters per, well, I should say approximately. So maybe let's make that approximately. 9.81 meters per second squared. And think, why is it negative? Take a moment to think about that. The answer is because we typically measure distance from the ground when we're talking about falling objects. So x equals 0 is going to be an object is on the ground, and then height is measured vertically, and if you're above the ground, x is greater than 0. So if your object is falling down, it has negative velocity, so the acceleration is going to be negative. Okay, so the gravitational force exerted upon a falling object is F equals ma by Newton's law, which is negative m times g. And here I'm assuming no air resistance. Okay, so next, let's figure out what happens if we have it. Let's add air resistance. Okay, so what's going to happen? Well, of course, it depends on the shape of the object, how thermodynamic it is. But the first thing we can say is that F equals negative mg. So the force that acts on the object, forces add. So it's going to be the gravitational force plus some air resistance force. And I'll write it like this, plus R. So the force that acts on a falling object is by gravity and then by air resistance. And they add up, so we can add them together like this. And now let's think about what R is. So I claim R does not depend on the height, x. Now, it will to some extent if we're talking about dropping things out of airplanes, because the air gets thinner as we go higher. But for now, let's just assume that the air pressure is constant. So if we're throwing things off buildings, in that case, the air resistance is approximately constant. We can assume it's constant. So in other words, air resistance depends only on velocity. So I'm going to write it as a function R of V. And so what's a good model? And as I said before, it depends whether or not we're dropping, say, a parachuter or just the general shape of the object. But a good model, it's not going to be perfect, but a good model is that R of V equals negative R times V, where R is a constant. Let's think about why this is. So, air resistance is proportional. So this is saying air resistance is proportional to velocity, but in the opposite direction. So let me write that down and we'll see if we can talk our way through this. Air resistance is proportional to velocity, but in the opposite direction. Okay, so first of all, suppose that V is zero, our object is suspended in air. Then in that case, there's not going to be any air resistance. So that checks out. Now let's suppose that velocity is small in either direction. So we have a ball maybe that we threw up in the air and it's just about at its peak, maybe a little bit before or a little bit after. Well, at that point, there's not much air resistance acting on the ball, so the air resistance is going to be small. And finally, if the velocity is fast, like if we have an object falling quickly, then it's going to have a lot of air resistance. And so that, yeah, that checks out with this as well. But a good way to think about, or an alternative way to think about what this means is when I say air resistance is proportional to velocity, so it means that if you double velocity, you double air resistance. And that's not exact, but it's approximately true. You know, think about when you drive your car with the windows open and you stick your hand out. If you drive twice as fast, you feel roughly twice as much wind, twice as much air resistance. So again, I want to stress this is a model. It, of course, depends on the shape and material of the object. If you have an object that is oblong or weirdly shaped, I don't know, maybe you have some object that something like this, and it's twisting and turning as it falls, air resistance is not going to be constant, as it's going to depend on exactly which orientation is as it's falling at a particular instant. But we can assume for now that air resistance is, that this is a good model. And let me mention that there are other models out there. Some people will assume that it's negative r squared v, or it's r to the 1.5, or something like that. But not only is this a reasonable model, but it's mathematically pretty simple to work with. Okay, so let's derive our equation now. And so here's what we have. Let's rewrite this in terms of velocity. So recall, first of all, that v, the derivative of velocity, is acceleration. So I'm going to write, So I'm going to write down what I just circled in red. So force is, let's call it F, which is M times A, which I can write down as M times V prime. And now I'm going to set that equal to this right here, equals negative mg minus rv. So we can divide through by m, and we have v prime equals negative g minus r over m times v. And this is a first order differential equation that describes the velocity of a falling object subject to air resistance, where we're assuming air resistance is of this form. Okay, so to summarize, we just derived the following ODE, where v is velocity and g is approximately 9.81 meters per second squared. It's so much easier to leave things in certain terms of g, the little letter, instead of 9.81. Okay, so let's say a few things about this equation. What does it remind you of? Well, it's you know, don't get distracted by these fancy constants. I claim this should remind you just of a decay to a value problem. So let me write that down. Let's compare to a decay to a value problem. Or I shouldn't say problem, I should say equation. In other words, one of this form, t prime equals k times a minus t. This is how we've seen it, but of course we can multiply this out and get k times A minus K times T. And that's more like what we have here. You know, in that case, this takes the... So in that form, this is K times A, and this is K times T. Okay, so let's put it in that form. In other words, let's put in that form. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put it in this form. So I'm going to factor out a k. In other words, I'm going to factor out whatever that coefficient of t, i.e. v, is. So I'm going to factor out an rm. So put it in that form. So let's see. So we have v prime equals negative g minus r over m v. So I said we're going to factor out that constant r over m. So now that first thing is going to be, so we need an m on top. There's still a g on top. We need an r on the bottom. And that has to, this whole thing has to be negative minus, and the idea, the reason why we factored that out is because to make it monic. So now we can see, just based on what we know from this equation, that A was our limiting temperature. So this guy is going to be our limiting velocity. And K, our constant, is R over M. So think about what limiting, so here, limiting temperature is what every cup of water in a room is going to approach. It's the steady state or equilibrium temperature. Think of what the analog is that is in the falling object. It's the velocity that every object is going to approach. And you know this, even if you've never studied math before, you probably know what terminal velocity is. And parachuters have a very low terminal velocity, and that's why they survive their fall. In fact, mice, I've heard, can survive their own terminal velocity. I have not Google fact-checked this, but I've heard that mice can survive their own terminal velocity, which I think that'd be so cool. Anyways, okay, so let's summarize what I said. So here, K equals R over M, and A equals negative M G over R, which is the limiting or the terminal velocity. Okay, so our solution, let's put a line here. So now that we've written our equation in the form that we know, remember, we know the solution to this right away. I mean, we've done this. So the solution to, let's put a star here. Let's put a double star here. The solution to our first equation is the temperature is A plus C E to the negative K T. So because we have this in our form, we can say that our solution, our solution to, let's call that double star, is V of T. So it's the ambient temperature, or in our case, the ambient, or the equilibrium velocity, negative mg over r plus c times e to the negative r over m times t. And we don't even, I mean, we could do this, but that's what we're going to get because we've solved this equation before. So as a remark, or remark/summary, is the initial, so the initial velocity my stylus is causing me problems here. There we go. Initial velocity is v of 0. Just plug in 0 and to right above here and see what we get. We get negative mg over r plus c. And our limiting velocity, or our terminal velocity, now this is, technically it's the limit as t goes to infinity of vt. That's formally what it is, and we've written down what that is. That's negative mg over r. And think about why that is. That's because as time goes on, this exponential dies off, and we're left with just this piece right here. Let's do an example. So we have a 70-kilogram object falling from rest, and we know its terminal velocity is negative 20 meters a second. So let's find the velocity and distance traveled after 2 seconds, and then how long does it take to reach 80% of its terminal velocity? Okay, so let me rewrite the equation that we need. So, because we can't see it anymore. So our ODE, oh, it's not negative, is V. V prime equals negative G minus R over M. I don't think we'll actually need this, but what we will need is that V of T equals negative MG over R plus C e to the minus R over MT. So let's use that right away. So V of T is, and we also know that this is, so we don't know what R is. We do know what M is, but we know this is negative 20. So V of T is negative 20 plus C e to the minus R over 70, that's our mass, T. And let's figure out what R is. We do know is we know that negative 20 equals negative mg over R. Mg over R, in other words, negative 70 g over R. So we can right away conclude, we can solve for R, and we get that R equals 7/2 g. So now I can write this as negative 20 plus C e to the, so now what's R over 70? Divide this by 70, we get 1/20, I think. Yes, that's correct. So we get e to the negative 1/20 g t. Let me box that because that's important. So now we've eliminated all our constants. And you know, remember, g isn't really, I mean, g is a constant, but it's fine to leave it like that because it's easier to write that than 9.81 divided by 20. Okay, so our question says find its velocity after 2 seconds. So that means that v, just plug in 2. V of 2 equals negative 20 plus 20 e to the minus, plugging in 2 for t, we get g over 10. And so that's one answer for part A. Now we have to find the distance. Now, how do we do that? Well, this should take you back to an integral calculus. Recall that the distance can be computed via an integral. So v is just x prime, and so x is can it be achieved by integrating v between a and b. So the distance between t equals 0 and t equals 2 is obtained by integrating our velocity, v of t, from 0 to 2. Now, this is something that we have not seen previously in this class. It didn't make as much sense to talk about how much energy, think of the temperature decay problem. It didn't make too much sense to say how much temperature was gained or how much energy was gained. I don't know what you get when you integrate temperature from t equals 0 to t equals 2, but I'm not sure what the units are, but it's not something that really, I'm sure it makes sense, but it's not something that we really use on a day-to-day basis, and it's not something that would really come up in a word problem. So a nice thing about these falling object problems is that I can ask you something like this, where the integral of our function actually has a meaning, an everyday meaning. So distance, let's do this. So let's integrate this from, let's plug in v, so we get negative 20 plus 20 e to the negative 1/20th g times t dt. So let's break this into two integrals. The first one is negative 20 t from 0 to 2. That's not hard. The next one, we have to be a little bit careful. So what I'm doing is I'm doing this, and then I'm doing that separately. So the second one is plus, we know how to integrate e to the kt, right? So the integral of this thing is the same thing divided by this constant k, which happens to be negative 1/20th g. So let's write this as 20 e to the minus 1/20th gt. This is our e to the kt divided by our k, which is negative 1/20th g. Recall the integral of e to the kt is dt is e to the kt divided by k plus c. I almost left out the dt and the c here just for to be quick, and thought better of it. Okay, so we need to evaluate this guy from 0 to, where are we? From 0 to 2. Okay, so this first one is easily seen to be negative 40. And the second one, well, let's see, when we plug in, let's just do this and see what we get. So this is negative 40. And now we have, so I'm going to pull out the constant, this whole constant, to make things easier. So that's negative 400 over g, and then times, if we plug in 2, we get e to the negative g over 10, and if we plug in 0, we get 1. So we end up getting negative 40 minus 400 over, that's g, times e to the minus g over 10. Can you read that? Minus g over 10. I'll make it a little clearer. G over 10 minus 1. And that is how far we've traveled in the first 2 seconds after falling from rest. Okay, let's do part B. How long does it take to reach 80% of its velocity? So, well, we have a formula for velocity, 80% of its terminal velocity. So velocity, recall, was negative 20 plus 20. Sorry that I had to erase everything. I haven't figured out yet how to erase just part of it at a time. I'm sure there's a way, but it doesn't hurt to get a clean slate, and I think it's nice to start from scratch here. So here's velocity, and terminal. So 80% of its terminal velocity, that's 80% of negative 20, so that is negative 16 meters per second. So let's just set this whole thing equal to negative 16 and solve for t. So if we do that, we add 20 to both sides. Let's see. So we have 20. That's right. Solve for t. So 20 e to the minus 1/20th g times t equals 4. Then we can write this as e to the negative 1/20th g times t equals 1/5. Now we take the natural log of both sides, and we get that negative 1/20th g times t equals natural log of 1/5. Do my little convention, and you get negative natural log of 5. Aren't whole numbers much better than fractions, right? And then we get that t equals, let's see, t equals 20 natural log of 5 over g, and there is our final answer. Okay, so I have one extra slide. Turns out that I don't need it. I thought I might need extra room to work. So that's a good place to stop.